Thanks for joining us today, Eastside family. It's wonderful to be back on this great Sunday. And if you're joining us on time, then obviously we've set our clocks back right. I'm Blake.
And I'm Amber. And this morning, we're continuing the series on the parables of Jesus. And I can't wait to see how God speaks to you this morning during the service. As always, we love to hear your comments and your feedback. If there's anything that we can do for you as far as how we can pray for you, or if you can comment and follow along on social media and let us know where you're listening from, we love that interaction with you.
So thanks for being with us today, and let's get ready for a great service.
There's no power like a power of Jesus. Let faith arise. shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Come on, Eastside family, let's sing that out together.
The Lord bless you. Gracious to you, the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen, amen, amen.
Children and their children and their children. blessed Trinity.
Eastside, it's so good to be with you today on Time Change Sunday. My name is Scott, and I bring you greetings from the Midlands of South Carolina, from the state capital of Columbia, and your sister church of Shandon Baptist Church. Meredith Jackson and I are excited to be with you today, and we want to let you know how much we love you and how much you're a part of our life. We're so grateful for our dear friends, John and Sharon Hull, and Daryl and Shelley Whipple. You are indeed a second family to us, and we're so honored to be a part of your worship today and to unpack the Word of God with you. Hey, we're continuing our message series, The Parables of Jesus, and we will be in Matthew chapter 25. We'll pick up verses 14 through 30, and today we'll be talking about the parable of the talents, and undoubtedly, it is a familiar parable to you, and I'm excited that we get to share with you and talk about this as the people of God. So as we begin today, let me pray for us. Well, Father, thank you for the truth of your word. We're grateful for its power and its ability to reach deep into our hearts and search and convict us. And Father, we're so grateful that Jesus shared this parable with his disciples and the truth that it has for us today. So, Father, thank you for the people of God at Eastside Baptist Church and the ministry in their community, for their leader, John Hull, and the effort that everyone in that congregation makes to reach the people of Cobb County. So, Lord, we pray that you would be with us today as we take a look at your word, and may it change our hearts and minds. And we ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, rather than reading the entire parable to you in one sitting, I thought I would allow the parable to unfold just as Jesus told it to his disciples in Matthew chapter 25, and then we'll rappel down into the text and uncover some fascinating and extraordinary truths that emerge naturally in the story. And perhaps to no one's surprise, my message title today is simply this: You've Got Talent. So with that, why don't we begin by reading together Matthew chapter 25, beginning in verse 14, and we'll read just the first two verses of this parable together. Jesus said, "For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, and to each according to his ability. And then he went away." Well, to see the parable of the talents in its context, it's important to understand that it follows immediately after the parable of the bridesmaids, the 10 bridesmaids or the 10 virgins. For these two parables are actually linked together. They're complementary. And in verse 14, as we just read, Jesus begins this parable by saying this: "For it will be like." Now, the word "it" here is linked to verse 1 of Matthew chapter 25, where Jesus refers to the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven, which is unique to the Gospel of Matthew. Now, most interpret this parable as a parable of judgment, and it most certainly is, considering the fact that it's linked to the previous parable in Matthew chapter 25, the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. But to fully understand the beauty and power of this parable, I think it's very important for us to say, put on a pair of bifocals, because this parable is also brimming with grace, which I think you'll be able to see in the few moments that we have together. Now, the parable is based upon a familiar custom in Jesus' day. Businessmen in the far-flung reaches of the Roman Empire would often travel to Rome in order to lobby for power or for favor of some kind. Some things never change, do they? Well, while they were away, of course, on these business trips, they would entrust their property or their assets to their servants. And so this was a common practice in Jesus' day. So in the parable of the talents, it's a man who sets out on a journey, but before he departs, he entrusts his property to 3 of his servants. Now, the word "property" here has a broad definition and can include a lot of things, including assets or valuables of any kind. But here we ought to pause as we step into the parable of the talents and clearly identify the man. For he is none other than Jesus himself, the Savior. And of course, as you might imagine also, the disciples are the servants. And in verse 14, it reveals that these are in fact his servants. And Jesus is very clear about this. And this distinction is important because it reminds us that we're talking about believers and not unbelievers. And so that's an important distinction to draw here at the beginning of our parable. Now, of course, Jesus knew at this moment in his ministry, as he spoke to the disciples, that he would be going away. But he also knew that he would be coming back, that there would be a glorious return on the horizon. So the message to the disciples here out of the parable of the talents is important for the disciples to understand at this moment in their relationship and their time with Jesus. From our perspective, we know about Jesus' record of saying that he would come back, but the disciples didn't really know this yet. And so it's important to understand that with regard to this parable. But as Jesus begins to intertwine the characters that are present in the parable of the talents, we encounter a life-altering truth, and that's this. We, you and I, are actually characters in this parable as well, for we are playing the role of the servants in the kingdom today. And so this is a timely message for us, and certainly it will grab our attention as we move forward into the text. Now, it's commonly understood, so you know a little bit about the background of Jesus' parable here, that a talent is something that we ought to pause and identify as well. It's important that we define what a talent is. Now, it's commonly understood among biblical scholars that a talent was not so much a sum of money or really even a currency as much as it was a weight of measure. And in Jesus' day, it was the largest weight in everyday use. Now, attempts to render an equivalency in today's currency run into difficulties. Some scholars think that a single talent was worth a lifetime of income for any man. Others are less certain. But the one thing that we can be certain about as far as a talent is concerned is that five talents represented an eye-popping, attention-grabbing sum of money. Two, of course, was no small amount, and one was not to be disregarded. But let's be really clear about the parable itself. The heart of this parable, the parable of the talents, doesn't rest in the unspecified weight of a talent or the sum total of a wealthy man's portfolio, but quite clearly it rests on the stewardship of God's grace in our lives, which I think we can agree is invaluable. And so this leads us to one of the principles that emerges from the parable of the talents. One of the primary ideas that Jesus is trying to communicate with His disciples, and it's this. As a servant of Christ, you are a steward of the grace that's been given to you. As a servant of Christ, you are a steward of the grace that's been given to you. Another way to say it is quite simply, you've got talent. But biblically understood, you're a steward of what God has given you, His grace. And given the value of grace, it's really quite humbling to realize just how much Jesus has invested in you and in me as His followers. But we have to stop and ask the question, what does this mean for us personally? If Jesus has made this investment in us, what does it mean and require of us personally? Well, the word talent comes into our English language through this particular parable. But even if you consider the definition of talent in today's vocabulary, it's a unique or special skill that someone has. We all recognize that our talents are not earned or achieved. They are, in fact, natural, or they're freely given. And from that point forward, we begin to develop those talents and develop those giftings as we move forward. But for our consideration here and for the purposes of understanding this particular parable, a talent is whatever God has entrusted to you in order to live out your faith personally and multiply its power in others. Very clearly, a talent is whatever God has entrusted to you to live out your faith personally and to multiply its power in others. So the real question that follows from that is, what should be our response? What should we do with the talent that's been given to us? Well, one of the great struggles in this parable is to understand the distribution of talents to the servants in the story. Much is made about the different amounts that each of the servant receives. One servant receives five, another one receives two, and another one receives only one talent. Well, what do we make of this? And how are we to understand what Jesus is trying to tell us today? Well, I think you'll agree with me that there's little doubt that today we live in a culture of comparison. In a world where social and economic distinction tends to emerge as our primary identity, certainly there is a way in which we will judge the owner that somehow he was unfair or unjust in his distribution plan. And certainly that's something that all of us might grab hold of when we read this parable and we think about the manner in which he distributed the talents. But here's what I think Jesus would really want us to know when it comes to this parable. In the economy of the kingdom, your natural endowments and the supernatural indwelling and gifting of the Holy Spirit really makes you spiritually wealthy. And what follows from that is a beautiful truth, and that's this. Jesus reminds us that a single ounce of His grace is more than sufficient for this life and the life to come. Jesus wants you to know that. So what is required of us? If we have been given natural talents through the grace of God, and we've been offered this through His Son, Jesus, what should be our response as servants, as stewards in the kingdom of God? What God wants us to do is to steward the grace that's been given to us and not just manage the grace that's been given to us. And believe me, there is a sharp distinction between stewardship and management. You see, management only focuses on what is. It's concerned primarily with present reality. It's concerned with protecting the status quo. But stewardship is very different because stewardship focuses on what can be. It is very future-oriented because it assumes, by definition, a future reckoning or a future accounting. And that's the difference between stewardship and management. And so these three servants were charged with stewarding the man's assets and not just managing the man's assets. And that's the heartbeat of this parable. Now, I grew up on the south side of Atlanta in a town called Fayetteville. Many of you are probably familiar with Fayetteville, or perhaps you've been there. It's much different today than it was when I was growing up many years ago. And during those formative years, as a young boy and teenager, my father owned a produce business at the farmer's market in Forest Park. And so from the time I was about 8 years old, it was expected of me that I would get up early in the morning when I didn't have school or sport responsibilities, ball teams, practice or games, and I would go to work with my dad. That was expected of me. And so we would leave early in the morning around 5:30 and arrive at the farmer's market, and the first couple of hours were always very busy because we were unloading boxes and bags of potatoes and onions and fruit. And then we would repackage the produce into smaller bags, 10, maybe 20 pound bags of produce or fruit. And then I would spend the rest of the day on the front steps where we would sell all of the produce to the customers who would come. Now, as a young 9 or 10 year old boy, I had the time of my life trying to sell people potatoes and onions and other kinds of produce. But at the beginning of each morning, my dad would give me $50 in cash. It was a cash-only business. And he would give me usually 2 tens, 3 fives, and 15 ones, small denominations with which I would make change for the business that would occur throughout the day. And so my job was to sell produce and grow that investment that my dad placed in me each and every morning. So I started each day with a vision of just how big that wad of money could become. Because folded over, $50 wasn't a lot. I could easily fit it into my pocket. But my goal by the end of the day was for that wad of money to become so big that it wouldn't even fit down inside my pocket. That was the vision I had. Now, as a servant of my dad, I knew that each day I was expected to return that expanded wad of money to my dad so that those dollars could be counted and then later deposited in the bank. Now, I didn't work on commission, and I never got a raise. I asked for a raise one time with my dad when I was a teenager, and he told me no because I was consuming all of the profits in the kitchen at the house. So I never got a raise. But the beautiful thing is each day, I would be entrusted with my father's assets, with a vision and hope that at the end of the day, I could eagerly present to him the return on his investment in me. Because you see, it wasn't my goal just to manage what he had given me early in the day and to protect that asset, but to steward it so that I could grow the investment in me and present to Him eagerly at the end of the day His investment in me. You see, there's always another person on the other side of the stewardship equation. And when it comes to the case of grace in our lives, there's always the Heavenly Father on the other side of the stewardship occasion. And that's the difference that I think Jesus wants us to see among these servants as they stewarded the man's assets. So returning to the parable, verse 16 tells us clearly this. He, the servant who had received the 5 talents, went at once and traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. And so also he who had the 2 talents made 2 talents more. Now it's important to notice here in verse 16 that the individual who received the 5 talents went at once. And that's an important distinction because he had a sense of urgency. There was a sense of urgent responsibility because he knew that delayed obedience is a form of disobedience. So this sense of urgent responsibility was certainly a part of his work ethic, but also he understood that time was money in this case. There was no time to waste. And so the first and second servants went to work. They doubled their investment. And then as the parable moves on, all eyes turn to the third servant, the 1 talent man. The entire parable, it seems, is told very simply to expose him. Everything else is prologue. All of the other characters really seem to be supporting cast members. And in verse 18, we read that the 1 talent man buried his talent in the ground. Now, of course, there were no banks, savings and loans, or brokerage houses in Jesus' day. And so the ground was really a safe place to put an investment, because this particular servant was cautious, he was frugal and afraid, and so he took no chances with what the owner had invested in him. The possibility of failure was like an icy fist around his heart. And then in verse 19, the tone of the parable turns ever so slightly as the owner returns to settle accounts with his 3 servants. And so as you know, the first 2 servants offer the results of their hard work eagerly. They're excited to meet the owner. The original investment is doubled, it says in Scripture, and all of it returned to the master, to the man in the story. And in verse 21 and 23, there is an affirmation and approval that we all long to hear from God at the end of our lives. As the man says to the 5 and 2 talent servants, "Well done, good and faithful servant." What a beautiful statement in Scripture. What a powerful moment for these 2 servants who heard from the owner, the affirmation that came with it. But it's this 3rd servant who hangs back, perhaps lingering in the shadows, as the first 2 servants approach and report to the man. The 3rd servant is not eager like the others, and I would imagine as he hears the affirmation that's been granted to the first 2 servants that he begins in his mind to formulate his defense, to formulate his excuse. And when it's his turn to report, we're astonished at what we read. So let's pick up in verse 24 and read through verse 25. Jesus said, "He also who'd received the 1 talent came forward saying," before the 3rd servant even got into the proximity of the master, he began talking so that he could proactively offer his excuses. And he said to the man, "Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid." And he went, says, and I hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. With one sweeping accusation, the one talent man blamed the owner for his own lack of productivity and return on investment. What a crushing statement this was. I think you'll agree with me that blaming has become a bit of an Olympic sport in our culture today, a quick and decisive way to size someone up and dismiss them. And it's tragic in our culture, but blame has a very, very long history, as it was the first formal justification for sin in the Garden of Eden. Adam was quick to blame God, and he was quick to blame his wife, Eve. But yet it was Adam who had received explicit instructions about what to do and what not to do in the garden. But he failed to communicate with his wife, perhaps lingering in the shadows while the serpent did what the serpent always does, and that's to deceive and to destroy. And the world was suddenly plunged into the darkness of sin. Men, I want to speak to you for just a moment and say this. One of our most persistent sins, and it's certainly present in Genesis, one of our most persistent sins is the sin of passivity. We sit back and do nothing. We bury what God has given us in the ground, and then we expect others to step forward and leverage their gifts, their passion, and their talent. God has not called us as men to be passive. And that's certainly true in this parable of the talents as well. And it was clear in Genesis that it was Adam who failed by becoming passive. Waiting on someone to leverage their gifts always creates consequences. Look, depending on your generational identity, one of the most awful passivity activities that we engage in today is that we sit around desiring to be entertained, and we slip into a state of passivity. So perhaps many of you, the silent generation, or perhaps the boomers, spend a lot of your time watching Fox News. Others that are younger, ESPN. Or perhaps you're into gaming, Xbox, or perhaps social media, and we all have a smartphone. And it has lured us into the sin of passivity. Man, this is not what God has called us to. As a follower of Christ, the gift of grace has been granted to us, and we must leverage it for purposes greater than our own comfort and our own entertainment. This is what God has called us to by entrusting to us the gift of grace. So in the text, it's difficult to overstate how the third servant completely misrepresented and miscalculated the owner. And this is precisely Jesus' point in the parable. You see, the owner's chief concern was the multiplication of his gracious investment. But the third servant lodged a complaint against the owner about sowing and reaping where he hadn't planted. But actually, if you look at the text, the opposite is true if you consider the whole story, because the owner had sown generously with all three men, just as he has sown generously with you and with me. He graciously left his servants in charge. He allowed them to invest independently and proactively. But tragically, this third servant projected a false understanding and a false image, an assessment of the owner's character. And it was this mindset, this sin, if you will, that formed a self-centered cocoon from which he could justify any and every excuse. A.W. Tozer was an American pastor and author. And many years ago, he wrote, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." just like the one talent man, what we think about God not only determines what we do for God, but also what we don't do for God. So what about you? What comes into your mind when you think about God? Do you believe that God is perhaps unjust or maybe even unfair? Or perhaps you think of God as even cruel or capricious, or what may be worse is that God is just actually uncaring. And yet, biblically, nothing could be further from the truth. And this is important. Because of this parable and many other parables in the New Testament, Jesus is making it clear that He's not asking us to live for grace. He is asking us to live from grace. It's an invitation to live from grace. And the reason we know that is because the owner didn't ask his servants to work for the talents that he gave them. He asked them to generate returns from the talents that he had given them. Of course, many of you know well Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, lest any man should boast." But verse 10 is powerful as well, because it describes the purpose of the gift of grace. It reminds us of the reason of God has entrusted to us His mercy and His grace. Because verse 10 says this, "For we are His workmanship." Literally here, poetry. It's where we get our English word poetry. "For we are His poetry, intricately and personally made, created in Christ Jesus," Paul goes on to say, "for good works." This word "good" is the same word that the owner uses in his affirmation of the first two servants. "Well done, good and faithful servants." The problem is when we harbor a false understanding of God, we'll naturally shrink back into a state of self-preservation and we'll bury what God has entrusted to us in the ground. And it's been my sad experience on occasion that one of the safest places to bury the grace that's been given to us, to hide the talent that God has given us, in the church. It is easy to take the grace that's been given to us and hide it in all the activity that occurs inside a church. Entrusted with the riches of grace and a membership card in a local church, we'll take those talents and we will bury them behind, well, church attendance, which is a good thing. But we can hide our talents and we can hide what God has given us in church attendance. We can hide behind correct doctrine or right answers. We can hide behind all of the programs that the church offers. We can hide behind our giving. There is so much that we can hide behind. And it is tragic to see our faith shrink because of the church. And yet it is the church collectively that calls us forward, that calls us out to leverage and invest those gifts that we have been given through our Lord Jesus Christ. Can we be honest for just a moment and say there may be some who are listening right now, believers who are faithful to the church, Christians who have buried their talent in beautifully carved boxes of church activity. So let's be honest about it. The 5 and 2 talent servants scare us a little bit, don't they? They probably make us frustrated or even uncomfortable, and when they do, we often run into the comfort and company of the other 1 talent servants. And before we know it, in the company of all of those 1 talent servants who are taking what God has given them and burying it in the ground, we begin to use them as the benchmark for our own faith. And because we can't be spectacular, because we can't be like the 5 or 2 talent servants, we then refuse to become, well, significant with what God has entrusted to us. And over time, we begin to believe that the grace that's been given to us, quite simply, is a form of insurance against difficulty and crisis in our life. You see, there's a big difference between insurance and investment. We all know this intuitively. An investment is leveraging what you've been given in hope of a future return. But insurance protects you from the possibility of future loss or future harm. If your faith is nothing more than an insurance policy to mitigate the possibility of future loss or harm, then you'll always settle for a zero net loss on the spiritual ledger of your life. And when it's all over, you'll approach God and offer to Him the lone talent that you started with. That's not what God has called you to. And this is what happens when we stop stewarding our faith and we start managing our faith. No vision, no relationship, and no return on investment. By grace, through faith, you were created in Christ Jesus for good works, for a return on the investment of grace. That's what Jesus is calling you to. Well, as we close today, there are a couple of things in the parable that we ought not miss. We really ought to pay attention to. Because you see, following the affirmation granted to the first two servants, where the man said, "Well done, good and faithful." Notice he didn't say good and flashy, but good and faithful servant. The owner adds two things in verse 21 and 23. First, he says to them, "You have been faithful over little, I will set you over much," or over many, as some translations say. And here we discover that reward for faithful stewardship is in fact greater responsibility. Expanded opportunity to steward kingdom resources. And when the owner says, "I will set you over much," we need to recognize that heavenly rewards are not beds of rest, but they are in fact posts of duty. Idleness is not a reward for faithful service. And in verse 28, we hear very difficult but necessary judgment from the owner regarding the third servant. He says very simply, "Take the talent from the lazy servant and give it to the one who has 10. You see, for those who choose only to manage their faith, they will eventually find that what's been entrusted to them is no longer serviceable. Use it or lose it, Jesus is trying to say. Unused muscles atrophy, unfruitful trees are chopped down and thrown away, Jesus said. You may say, "Well, that seems unfair. That doesn't seem right to me." Well, is it fair, I should ask, for a minimally gifted person to live their whole life in service to their own comfort and their own security? I think the answer is no. You see, the harsh judgment that emerges at the end of the parable underscores a reward for selfish preoccupation, because it will result in a life of regret, missed opportunity, and misspent chances. But according to the owner, there's another outcome we can choose. And this is the beauty, the grace that brings this parable to a conclusion. Because you see, after entrusting the first two servants with expanded responsibility, the owner then says to them, "Enter into the joy of your master." Enter into the joy of your master. You see, the talent that God has entrusted to you has an ultimate purpose in your life, and that is to bring you joy. But to get to joy, We have to know a very specific truth that's present here in this parable, and we cannot miss it. And that's this. There is no joy without risk. There is no joy without risk. You see, both the first and second servants assumed a level of risk when they went to work with their assigned talents. And in the eyes of the third servant, investment was really an unacceptable risk. And by hiding his talent in the ground, as we discovered in Scripture here, he disqualified himself from the possibility of joy in his life. So you may say, well, Scott, does that mean we serve a God of risk? Is that what you're saying? Well, let me answer it this way. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 7, Paul writes this and tells us that Jesus risked everything by emptying himself and taking on the form of a servant. And he became obedient to the point of death, death on a cross. And then Jesus entrusted the future of the kingdom for which he had died, the message of the gospel, to a handful of undistinguished, uneducated Galileans. That, my friend, is a risk. And it's the same risk that he has invested in you. There is no joy without risk. Jesus is calling you to take what he has entrusted to you and multiply it for kingdom purposes. But there will be risk. In C.S. Lewis's classic book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, there is a beautiful dialogue between Susan, one of the four children, the Chronicles of Narnia, and Mr. Beaver. It's one of my favorite passages in the book. Mr. Beaver explains for the first time that Aslan, who represents and embodies Jesus in the Chronicles of Narnia, is in fact a lion. And so Mr. Beaver says, Aslan is a lion, the great lion. Ooh, says Susan, I thought he was a man. Is he quite safe? I shall feel rather nervous about meeting a lion. Safe? Mr. Beaver asks incredulously. Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he is good. He's the king, I tell you. What Jesus risked for you requires a response from us. And I know many of you have offered your talent, living in the shadows of 2 and 5 talent servants. And yet it is God who is calling you to take that lone talent, or those 2 talents, or those 5 talents, and invest them for kingdom purposes. Many of you have used your talents beautifully for kingdom purposes, right here at Eastside. We're so grateful for what you've done. So may we merge together with others who are committed to investing their talent for kingdom purposes. We're so excited about what God is doing at Eastside. We want you to know that your talent is a necessary response to the grace that has been given to you. But we would ask you, beg you, not to become a manager of your faith, but to become a steward of your faith and reap the joy that is yours as a servant of Christ. That's my prayer for you. Let's pray together. Well, Father, we thank you for the power and the grace that is present in the parable of the talents. Father, may we always cling to you, knowing what you have entrusted to us in the person of your Son, Jesus. Father, there is a grace that is ours. And the manifestation of that grace is what you're calling us to steward. Father, may we never shrink back and bury that talent, that faith in the ground, wrapping it in church activity. But Father, may we always be conscious and aware of kingdom returns. So Father, I pray for the people of Eastside and others who may be watching today, Lord, that they too may find their talent, to understand it, to appreciate it, and to give you glory for what you have done in their lives. And may that talent be the soil from which kingdom returns would grow. So Father, thank you for what you have entrusted to us. And we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Again, thanks for being with us this Sunday. And don't forget, our times of service are 9:30, 11, and 6 p.m. If you want to stay a little bit more connected with us, check out our app or follow eastside.com.
Our app and our website are great ways to stay connected to Eastside. They're also a great means to register for upcoming events, such as this Tuesday, we have Student Tuesday nights. And believe it or not, we're already starting to register for our Easter service, and we would love for you to spend that with us. So we're so happy that you joined us this week, and we can't wait to see you again next week.